So welcome everybody to this new webinar, Friend of the Sea webinar. Before we start, just a few information about how does it work. If you have some questions, you can write your questions in the question and answers chat. Answers will be provided at the end. Because of the high number of participants, only speakers can use audio. A recording of this webinar and PowerPoints will be sent via email link. If you want to have this webinar, just write us and request us. So, what is the subject of this webinar today? Whale and dolphin watching, the importance of sustainability certification to regulate the industry. First of all, I would like to introduce myself to you. My name is Mario Passoni, and I'm the scientific officer at Friend of the Sea. With me today, we have a very super special guest that is Jessica Lessi, founder and scientific director of Associazione Meris. Some information about our society, Friend of the Sea. So, Friend of the Sea has born 12 years ago. And the target of this society is to increase the sustainability of the oceans. And for re this reason, has been created a lot of projects related to the sustainability of the oceans. And the core of our actions are about sustainable fisheries and aquaculture products. Friend of the Sea has certified over than 1,000 companies from more than 100 countries worldwide. Friend of the Sea has a kind of a sister that is a friend of the Earth, that is similar, but is about the certification of products coming from sustainable agriculture and farming. Both of the societies belong to a bigger society that is called the World Sustainability Organization. So, before starting this webinar, I think would be good to have a short introduction about the history of whale and dolphin watching. So I guess everybody knows what is a whale watching activity, but there are a lot of persons that doesn't know when it started officially. It was in the 1955, and the first water-based whale watching commenced in San Diego. And at the beginning, the price for these excursions was very low, was around $1 per trip to view the whales. And during the first years of activities, there were something like 10,000 visitors on board. And then the business has increased, and now we have around 13 million people across over 100 countries go whale watching. So, as you can understand, the number of visitors, the number of boats, operators that are making whale watching has increased a lot. And for this reason, we have created a standard of sustainability in order to give a code of conduct for these operators. But how can we go whale watching? There are different options, basically. The most common one is by boat. Then there is the possibility of going by kayak. It's even possible to spot whales from the coast, or if you are brave enough, from the helicopter and small airplanes. So, as I told you, for this reason, since the whale watching activities have increased a lot, we decided to create this standard of conduct. And last year, we met and we partnered with Associazione Meris. Associazione Meris is led by Jessica Lessi, as I told you. And now I would love to introduce her to you. Just give me a couple of seconds, and she will introduce herself. Jessica, please let me know if you can speak.
Hello, everybody. I hope that you can hear me well. Well, I'm Jessica Lessi, the Scientific Director of Associazione MERIS. MERIS is a non-profit organization whose mission is to protect marine mammals in the Mediterranean Sea, with a special focus on cetaceans living in the Sicilian Channel. The Sicilian Channel is located in the South Italy, between the western coast of Sicily and the North African coast. These waters connect the western and the eastern Mediterranean basins. It's an area with a high productivity and a hotspot biodiversity. Our working area extends for about 800 square kilometers in the waters in front of Agrigento province. When I founded MERIS about 8 years ago, I chose this area because despite the importance of the Sicilian Channel and the high number of dolphins stranded, there was no scientific knowledge about the cetaceans population living in these waters. We have no knowledge about their presence, abundance, and distribution. So MERIS was born with the aim to fill this knowledge gap. We conduct two main activities. The first is the scientific research. We are carrying out studies aimed at protecting cetaceans and at quantifying and reducing anthropogenic impacts. And our second goal is to improve people's awareness about the importance of the sea and its conservation. For this reason, we are carrying out many divulgation events and educational activities. In particular, we gave the opportunity to people to come on board with us during our monitoring day at sea. And we have two programs. The program a researcher for a day allow people to see dolphins in their natural environment just for one day on board with us. For those who want to know more about cetaceans monitoring and learning the cetaceans monitoring techniques can participate to our training course that lasts for minimum 1 week during the summer season. With our activities, MERIS joined in the 2018 the Ocean Action Hub Voluntary Commitment, that it's a project of the United Nations whose aim is to implement and achieve 17 Sustainable Development Goals through global action. The goal 14, to which we adhere, regards the life below water. And in 2019, we started our collaboration with the Friends of the Sea, which I deeply thanks. And we gained the label as a sustainable scientific research group. And I'm very proud that MERIS was the first organization to be certified. From this year, our research on bottlenose dolphins are supported by Lush Italy, which I deeply thanks. And for those who want to know more about our activities or want to support us or join us in Sicily, please feel free to get in touch with me through our website, merisresearch.com, or through our social network or by mail. Well, after this brief introduction, I can talk about the main topic of this webinar, that is the whale and dolphin watching. It's a touristic activity that could have many benefits, but also many impacts, and all depend how the watching activities is conducted. Potentially, whale watching is a sustainable use of cetacean, and it's an economically viable alternative to whaling. Whale watching is rapidly growing all around the world. In many countries, it's become the major contributor to tourism sector, and has been estimated to generate in 2009 over $2 billion and provide employment for over 13,000 people. Whale watching also has the ability to improve people's attitude toward the marine environment, promote public awareness, and support for the conservation issues that targeted the species face. In many countries, whale watching companies cooperate with the scientists, and it's a great advantage for the scientific research, since since whale watching vessels can serve as valuable platform of opportunity to collect data on whales and dolphins distribution, habitat use, and long-term photo identification studies. This allows to study whales and dolphins with the cost effectively. At the same time, if no rules were followed during the whale and dolphin watching, this can cause can put cetaceans at risk of being harassed and injured, or can cause great stress to the animals, putting at risk the cetaceans population and the whale watching industry itself. The impacts of the whale and dolphin watching has been classified into short-term, long-term, and non-visible effects. Short-term effects include the changes in swimming behavior, such as deeper and more frequent dives, or fast changes in direction. These are evidence behavior, and how strongly whale and dolphin react is affected by the distance and the number of the vessel, with a stronger response when the vessel is closer and the number of boats is higher. This short-term behavioral effects could have long-term impacts to individual whales or dolphins or to whale populations, and it will depend on how frequently the same pods are exposed to whale-watching activities, and also which of their behaviors are interrupted. In fact, whales or dolphins that are often interrupted during important behaviors such as feeding, resting, or nursing are more impacted than animals that are in transit or are socializing. Long-term impacts are more difficult to measure, are very difficult, since whales and dolphins are long-lived animals. They can live from 20 to over 100 years, depending on the species, and as such, measuring long-term impacts needs can only occur in populations that have been studied before the whale watching began, in order to have a baseline of the pre-tourism population number, behavior, and distribution. This population then need to be monitored for many years before significant changes in distribution or population number can be detected. But in the country where these effects have been monitored, whale watching results in a decrease in population size and a movement of the animal away from the touristic area. Non-visible effects are also very difficult to monitor, especially in wild animals, and it includes increased levels of the stress hormones cortisol and aldosterone. Cumulative stress is known to be linked to disease and lower rates of survival in marine mammals, so it's a very serious issue and should not be taken lightly. Another issue is the noise from boat engines that can mask sound that animals use for echolocation and to communicate each other, forcing them to produce sounds loudly and to vocalize more loudly and more frequently. This is potentially devastating for a species that relies heavily on the sounds to communicate and for feeding. The disruption of communication and hearing is likely to affect the most vulnerable members of groups, such as mothers and calves. In conclusion, the potential severity of impacts from whale watching will vary between different species, geographical location, and group composition. The fair mother and calf are surely the most vulnerable, since as calves are limited in speed and mobility and are highly dependent on their mother. But a variety of management measures and regulation can be applied in order to reduce the impact that whale watching activities can have on these beautiful animals. And for this reason, people should choose company, whale and dolphin watching companies that are certified as sustainable operators. Well, I led the work tomorrow that will talk about the standard of Friends of the Sea for a sustainable whale and dolphin watching.
Okay, thank you, Jessica. And yes, so why we created this standard? Our target is to reduce as much as possible the human impact on cetaceans coming from the touristic activities like dolphin and whale watching. First of all, you have to know that the certification is a voluntary certification. So every operator from all the globe can apply for this standard. And to get the certification, the certificate has to show and respect some rules. So here is there is the first page of our checklist. I created this in collaboration with different experts and based on the best scientific evidence available and based on my personal and our experience. So how does it work, our checklist? Here I put an image of two different sections. So there are different sections of sustainability. For example, the number 4 is about the sperm whales and the number 5 about swim with cetaceans. So as you can see, there is the number of the requirement, there is the requirement and the level of the requirement. The level of the requirement is fundamental. We have two different levels. One is essential, one is a recommendation. So a requirement can be classified as essential or as a recommendation. In order to achieve the certification, the operator has to respect all the essential requirements. So we need to assess if they do respect all these requirements. And if they don't respect this criteria, we give enough time to them to comply with. And in this way, we can, if it's necessary, we can have an improvement of this society. The recommendations are just, in this phase, are just input and target to be achieved in the future. So are not fundamental to achieve the certification. Once they pass the assessment that we call audit, they get this certificate, the poster. They can expose on their boat or in their office this. So in this way, you know, you are aware that you are choosing a Friend of the Sea sustainable operator. The certification lasts 3 years and is subjected to surveillance audit and even to ghost observers observation and audit. In this way, we are able to monitor their activities. There is also the opportunity for you, if you are a tourist on board, to get in touch with them. If you have a look about this poster, you can find below on the right corner a QR code and also our link to our website, the link to our website, and you can communicate with us. In this way, you can tell us if the operator has respected all the requirements of sustainability, or otherwise you can even send us a beautiful picture or videos of the tour. Okay, so to get in the detail about the most important requirements in our standard, I would love to pass the word to Jessica again. So give me just a few seconds and she will explain us how does it work in the detail.
Okay, just the main rules to avoid the cetacean disturbance, and the full standard is downloadable freely from the Friend of the Sea website. The first rule regards the distance from whales and dolphins. The minimum distance to approach cetaceans is 100 meters from whales and 50 meters from dolphins. In the area between 300 meters to the minimum distance, called the watching zone, boats shall keep a slow and constant speed, no greater than 5 knots. And when dolphins and whales approach voluntarily the boats while cruising, the boats shall keep the same speed and don't change direction. These rules are very important to avoid collision between the boat and the animals. The boats never intentionally approach cetaceans head-on or from the rear. The approach must begin with an inclined route or of approximately 30 degrees with respect to the route of cetaceans to become gradually parallel to the route. Care shall be taken to make sure that no boat is dispersed, as more of all, nor calves and juveniles are separated from their mothers. Only one boat at a time can stay in the watching zone, while the other boat must wait outside over 300 meters. And the time spent in the watching zone shall be limited to 30 minutes, and this time is reduced to 15 minutes if there are other boats, other watching boats waiting outside. Engines shall be placed in neutral when boats stop in the watching zone, and it's very important to reduce the acoustic noise. And finally, the friend of the sea standard forbids to swim with wild whales and dolphins. But why is not recommended? Surely, I suppose that swimming with this animal is an unforgettable experience. Sadly, it's very difficult to ensure that the encounter is not a stressful experience for the animals. In some locations, wild whales or dolphins are highly disturbed by boats, which tend to drop swimmers in the waters as close as possible to the animals, increasing the risk to injure the dolphin or whale by boat propellers. Furthermore, many studies indicated that in some areas with the intense commercial swim tours, whales or dolphins are actually leaving their habitat in favor of quieter areas. And as I explained before, there is concern that disruption to feeding, resting, nursing, and other behavior could have long-term impact on the health and well-being of individuals and populations. Another consideration to do is the safety of scuba divers. Whales and dolphins are large and powerful animals, and if they feel in danger, they are capable of injuring people in the water, either on purpose or accidentally. Furthermore, like all mammals, cetaceans are protective of their young and calves. So if a mother feels some risk for her calves, they can develop aggressive behavior. Another concern is the two-way disease transmissions. Dolphins can carry disease that can be transmitted to humans and vice versa. Finally, in some areas, swim tour operators offer cetaceans food, encouraging them to remain in the vicinity of the swimmers. And this practice might encourage begging behavior and causing the cetaceans to neglect their normal foraging activities. Very recent studies demonstrated that female reproductive success and calf survival were negatively influenced by food provisioning, and furthermore, it increased the individual risk for injury and death. Well, thank you for listening, and I give the word to Mario to conclude this presentation.
Okay, thank you very much, Jessica, for your explanation. So, I would love to focus about on this slide, because it's very important. It's about mono-use plastic on board. It's a real hot topic. If you ever been on board during a whale watching tour or just simply sailing at the sea, you know that most of the time the wind is blowing And if you have a bottle of plastic bottle of water or a straw, it's pretty easy that can throw at the sea and float at the sea. It happened even to me, and it's very frustrating, and it's very impacting on the environment. So we all know that the plastic, the microplastic, is a huge problem for our oceans. And for this reason, we strongly believe that we strongly want to put this requirement, this essential requirement, in this checklist, because we want to start from this to avoid the dispersion of plastic at the sea. And in my experience, I've seen that can be easily respected, and the impact can be bigger than we think. So this is just one of the examples of the requirements that we put. I mean, all of them are fundamental in order to protect what we love. At the end of this webinar, I would like to talk about a case study, a project that we developed in collaboration with Associazione Meris in Lampedusa Island. It happened last summer. Basically, we got in touch even with another person that I've seen is following us, and is Giulia Visconti, that is managing the marine protected area of Lampedusa and Linos Island. And we decided to do something in order to regulate the activities about dolphin watching around the beautiful Lampedusa Island. So in a very few weeks, we arranged it all. It was super positive, super nice. And we went to Lampedusa and we trained the local operators. And basically, the local operators are the fishermen, the local fishermen. And has been impressive for me, because they really care about what they have, and they understood perfectly the message that we want to give. And the message is to protect what we have and protect what we love. And they do, and they are doing. So we trained them, and we went out with their boat in order to assess how do they behave with the dolphins. And they achieved the certification. Last year, five fishermen, five boats achieved the certification. And this year, probably the number of them will increase. And we are very, very, very happy about it. So if you can, go and visit Lampedusa and ask for a certified dolphin watch tour. And here we can see a very nice picture of the boat of Salvatore, of Salvo, with our Friend of the Sea flag. Okay, so by my side, that's it. But now is time for questions and answers. So if let me remind you, if you have questions, just go on the left of your screen where there is written Q&A, and simply ask. I will allow Jessica to talk. In this way, we can reply together to the questions. I already seen that there are question for us. The first question is, how many whale and dolphin watching operators have been certified a Friend of the Sea worldwide? In which countries? So thank you for your question. At the moment, we have 13 certified touristic operators and four scientific groups. And the number of both operators and scientific groups will increase. In which countries? We have mainly in Italy, then we have in the south of Spain, and we have also in New Zealand. Then, another question. Thank you for this great presentation. When a company applies When a company applies, sorry, for certification, will the activities of other boats operating in the area have an impact of the issue of the certification? No. No, we certify the operator under audit, but we cannot think to certify or to consider the activities of other persons or other operators. By my experience, my personal experience, the biggest problem usually are coming from the rent-a-boat activities, because they are normal people. And they are not aware about how to behave with cetaceans, and even if they want to respect, they do not have enough knowledge about how to behave with the cetaceans. Then a consideration, I don't think is a question, but thanks a lot. What a great way to provide comfort to whale dolphin watch participants that the activity is certified. Plus, the whale watch company can then leverage the FOS brand, promoting worldwide conservation and sustainability. Thanks a lot. Another question. What do you think to have a specific region, long coastal area of about 20 kilometers, with all the boat operators be certified? Well, would be great. Would be great. Would be a dream. I mean, as I said previously, this is a voluntary certification. So, if all the operators agrees in getting certified, all the requirements will be respected. But I mean, is enough just one not sustainable operator to create an impact on the cetaceans? Then another consideration, brilliant presentation. Congratulations to you too. Thank you very much. Another question. If you don't have a certificate as a whale watching company, what are the consequences? Depends. If you have a certificate, you can show and demonstrate to your customers that you are sustainable. By our point of view, is an added value in terms of marketing and business. And at the moment, is the only way to show that you are really sustainable. Somebody in some parts of the world are making a kind of auto certification, but of course it's not enough by our point of view, because there should be a third party assessing that you are sustainable. Aside from the certification, what benefits does a company have? Is there a collaboration with law enforcement to keep in check non-certified companies? We are working on it. We are working on it, and we are developing some systems, but it's not that much easy. I mean, needs time, needs time. But we are moving on this direction. Another question. You mentioned that the scientific groups certified. Do they have the same criteria for certification? No. This is a good question. Thank you. No, of course, there are some differences. And if you go on our website on the dedicated page, you will find both checklists, one for touristic operators and the other one for the scientific groups. Of course, there is a difference. For example, Jessica before was talking about the distance that has to be kept. But for scientific reasons, if, for example, you have to get a tissue sample from the animal, you have to get closer. So some requirements are are changed, and due to this necessity, let's say. Do you agree, Jessica, on this?
Yes, I want just to add that scientists know very well the behavior of animals, and scientists know how to interpret it. So for this reason, I think that we know how, when is the case to leave the animals in their environment and don't go on with the observation, even if it's for a scientific purpose. For this reason, it's possible to make this little difference between touristic operators and scientific operators. It's all.
Okay, thanks, Jessica. Jessica, yes. Just coming back to the previous question, where we have certified operators, even in Sri Lanka and Gibraltar, in the south of Spain. Okay, another question. Do you have any kind of control towards boat operators and how they behave? The main issue in the ocean is the lack of control to make sure these guidelines are followed. Thanks. Still, we cannot control all the operators for the moment. we just can monitor who wants to get certified. The strategy is that if the number of certified operators in a certain area will increase, and the people is aware about the sustainable operators, what we hope is that people with the time will choose only sustainable operators. In this way, even if the other operators don't really want to be sustainable, they will feel, let's say, the need to get certified and respect the requirements of sustainability. Otherwise, they will risk to lose clients. I know it's sad to say something like this, but it's a way to move on. And only the government can put these strong rules on the operators. And regarding this, we are starting also collaborations with government. And our target in the future is to provide them with our criteria of sustainability and guidelines for a responsible whale-watching tour. All Dolphin Watch certified boats have Friend of the Sea flag? Yes, they should have. They should have, yes. once they get certified, we used to provide them with the flag, with the posters, and so on. Another question. We have a lot of questions. Sometimes imposing these sustainability rules may impact the economic revenue of a tour operator. How can you convince them to get certified then? Is a concrete question, this. I don't think they can impact on the economic revenue of the tour operator. And if this certification, if it's used in the right way, can improve, can increase the economic revenue of the tour operators. So I strongly believe that this is an advantage in terms of revenue. The point is that we need both Friend of the Sea and the operator, we need both to highlight this certification. We have to show that we are proud about this certification. And people, when get on board, has to be aware about it. For this reason, we request to all our certified operators to introduce all the customers on board during the initial briefing. Okay, let's say the last two questions. In Mauritius, dolphin and whale watching is very big. We could have about 30 boats on a small pod of 25-50 cetaceans. Do you have examples around the world where certification has helped change behavior of all operators? Here we have guidelines which are the same time to what Jessica explained, but they are not respected. Depends, because, for example, last year I've been to New Zealand, to Kaikoura, in the south of New Zealand, and there are a few number of operators, and I certified one kayak operator, and they found a kind of deal in order to do not get out altogether, in order to be, let's say, alone and spot the cetaceans alone. In some areas, I know it's chaotic. The solution should be to schedule the trips in different with different timings. So let's start at 8, and then another boat at 8:30, another boat at 9, and so on. And try to go in different location and directions. But again, at the moment, we cannot work on non-certified companies. But if you want to know more about it, and this is a recommendation for all of you, just write us, and we can discuss about it and even find together a solution, because every situation, each situation is different in different parts of the world. So it's better to discuss case by case. Okay, then the last two questions. Is there a fee for the certification? Yes. First of all, there is a price for the audit, but even then, very depends where is the operator that should be certified, and so on. And then there is a fee for the use of our logo. In still, we have an active promotion about the use of our logo. If you achieve the certification the first year, is free of charge. So again, if you want more details, everything is written on our website on the dedicated page, or you can simply write us. I think will be enough for today. If you have other questions, you can simply write us, and we will be glad to answer to all your questions. If you are a scientific group and you are interested in our certification or collaboration in order to develop together our projects, you are more than welcome, so contact us. And the last thing is about our brand new initiatives in Friend of the Sea and Friend of the Earth. Recently, we have started conservation projects through campaigns and petition activities. So follow our social channels, Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram, and get updated about it. If you want to know more, just write us. Okay, Jessica, do you want to add something?
I just want to thank you for inviting me, and thank you, Friend of the Sea, and everybody that attended the webinar.
Okay, so thanks a lot to everybody, and have a nice day. Bye-bye.
Bye, ciao.